Maybe the sound system wants me to do the singing. But unfortunately, if there is one thing that I cannot do in public and even when I am alone, that is to sing. Unfortunately, even though I tried since I was a child, practice singing in the comfort room, until now, that talent was not given to me. But our study tonight is, I hope, for someone like me who wants to learn how to sing. Last night, in our study, we tried to discover what kind of home did God prepare for us. We've learned that there is a home that God promised for us, and that home is in heaven. A place where is a place that is full of joy, a very peaceful place for us to live. And in that place that God promised us, we will never experience sorrow. We will never experience death. We will never experience pain. And it is the best place for us to live simply because God is there. And that place that God promised to us is actually a beautiful place, because God is the one ruling on that place. And tonight, we will try to discover the reason behind the promise of God. Why did God give us the promise about heaven? But before we go on, let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Let us pray. Our dear kind Heavenly Father, we'd like to thank you, Lord, for giving us another opportunity to study your word. And tonight, Lord, may your Holy Spirit be with us. Give us understanding from above so that we can be able to get the message you have prepared for us tonight. Bless us, Lord, and forgive us from all the sins that we have committed against thee. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. The title of the message for tonight is Together Again. I don't know if you know the thing. I think there is a song entitled Together Again, but that is not our topic for tonight. Our focus for tonight is to answer the question, why does God wants to bring us to heaven? Why is it that God promised us that there will be a home for us in heaven? If you will look at John 14 verse 3, it says here, "And if I go to and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." The very simple answer to the question is that God wants that wherever he is, his people will be there. In Isaiah 59 verse 2, it says, "But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear." Sin separates us from God. You know, when Adam and Eve committed sin, it creates a barrier between them and God. And because of that, they cannot commune with God face to face. Because of that sin, the full experience between humanity and God can never happen. And because of that, God wants to do something. And because of his love for us, he creates an antidote to that problem. God wants to restore humanity in its fullness and to be with them forever. God, that is the desire of God for us. He wants to restore us into our fullness, just like what Adam and Eve experienced, and to be with us forever. God wants to be reunited with his children, and heaven will be the place where it will happen. Despite of that barrier, God wants to be with us again. And he doesn't only wants to be with us again, but he also wants to be with us in the very best place that He can give us, and that will be heaven. The question for tonight is, what will happen during our reunion with God in heaven? I believe that there is always a reason behind everything, and God wants us tonight to learn the reason behind why what we will be doing when we will be in heaven with Him. The first thing that I've discovered as we go to heaven is that we will be having a fellowship in heaven. And this kind of fellowship, I believe, will be the best fellowship that you will ever experience. It says in 1 Thessalonians 4:16 to 17, "For the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord." It says that this reunion in heaven will be a fellowship with our loved ones who died. On that day, when Jesus Christ will bring us to heaven, those people whom we know, who live faithfully to God, will be with us again in heaven. Despite of the short time that we have been together with these people here on earth, someday in heaven, we will be with them again. And I do believe that it will be a very good experience to be with those people. Those precious people that we've lost in this earth, we will meet them again. I don't know if you have someone who is very special to you who died already. But this experience in heaven, I believe, will be a hope for us to see them once again. And it says in Matthew 8:11, "And I say unto you that many shall come from the east and west and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven." It says here, it will be a fellowship between the faithful people of God in heaven. You know, as I try to read the Bible and I try to read stories about the people in the Bible, there are so many questions that came up into my mind. And I said that someday, if I will be with heaven and I will be able to meet these people, I will ask those questions. And truly, the Bible says that we will have an experience to have a fellowship with these people. Someday in heaven, we will meet those peoples whom we are just reading in our Bible. It will not be anymore just a study of them through reading the Bible. We will not only see them in the Bible stories with pictures that I don't know if they are actually accurate. But time will come, we will be able to see them face to face. Next. In Revelation 21:3, it says, "And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people. And God Himself shall be with them and be their God." This is the best part of the fellowship in heaven. It will be a fellowship with our Redeemer. You know, as I try to imagine what will it be when we will see God or we face to face, I do believe that there is a happiness that we cannot imagine when that time will happen. Imagine that time wherein we will meet our God. The next thing that will happen in heaven, of course, is that there will be worship in heaven. It says in Revelation chapter 22, verse 3, "And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and His servants shall serve Him." Actually, the first time I read this verse, Actually, when I'm reading this verse, I read it from an Adventist book, and I said, the book is actually discussing about worship in heaven. But when I try to read the text, there is no word worship in the text. And as I try to study about this text, I've discovered something. If you will notice, the word serve is mentioned in the text, and it says here the Greek word is latreuo, meaning to serve or minister to. In the New Testament, to render religious service or homage, to worship, to perform sacred services, to worship God in the observance of the rites instituted for His worship. The text is telling us that in heaven, worship will be one of our activities. And it is not only one of our activities. As I try to study more, I've discovered something. It says in Isaiah 66:23, and it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord. And when I also try to study about this text, actually there are so many suggestions about what really this text means. But there is something that catch my attention. This text is actually telling us that in heaven, worship is a part of the daily experience of all who will be there. It says here, the redeemed would be worshiping daily at the throne of God. This is not actually, as I try to study more, this text is telling us that worship is not just a part of the day of the redeemed people, but this is what will be their life in heaven. It says here, finally, we will meet God face to face. We will be with the one who died on the cross to save us from our sins, and there is nothing best that we can do but to worship our God. You know, when I read this part in one five book, I remember how Jesus Christ suffered on the cross. It reminds me of how Jesus Christ suffered just to save us from our sins. Imagine the sacrifice of Jesus Christ just to give us a new life. And as I try to contemplate on that experience of Jesus Christ, and when I've learned that someday I will be with Him face to face, it gives me a great joy that I've never experienced before. Finally, I will be with that God who gave His life for me on the cross. The song says, what a joy that will be. What's the next? When my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon His face, the one who saved me by His grace. Imagine that kind of experience. And out of joy, according to what I've read, there is nothing that we can do but to worship Him. Give glory and praises to His name because of what He has done for us. And as I try to study about it, I've discovered something that somehow gives me a hope despite that I am not used to seeing in this earth. You know, music or song is a very has a very big role in the worship in heaven. And the Bible is actually telling us, the Bible, the Spirit of Prophecy is telling us, how will it be? Even though it is hard to actually really imagine because we are still not there. But I hope that as we study more about this, we will be able to have at least a glimpse of what will be our experience in heaven. It says in Revelation 15:2-4, "And I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, Great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. Who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? For thou only art holy. For all nations shall come and worship before thee, for thy judgment are made manifest." Actually, if we will go further with this, this is actually showing us something regarding what will be the focus or the theme of our songs in heaven. And it says here, "The days of pain and weeping and are forever ended. The King of glory has wiped the tears from all faces. Every cause of grief has been removed. Amid the waving of palm branches, they, the redeemed, pour forth a song of praise, clear, sweet, and harmonious. Every voice takes up the strain until the anthem swells through the vaults of heaven." Actually, if you will read the whole part wherein it was mentioned in the one of the book of Ellen White, it is actually telling us that as the people of God, even during the time that the redeemed people will be entering heaven, this is actually what will be their experience. You know, as they remember what happened to them, the pain that they've endured here on earth, and as they try to remember how they suffered in so many ways, there will be nothing that they can actually do but to praise God for saving them from those experience here on earth. Imagine, this actually happens during the time that the redeemed are still entering heaven. When they are just about to experience what God had prepared for them, they are already singing praise to God, glorifying His name, because finally they were delivered from the sin and the suffering that the sin gave them. Imagine their experience, and imagine how will it be if we will be part of those people who will be experiencing the glorious heaven that God prepared for us. As the nation of the saved look upon the Redeemer and behold the eternal glory of the Father shining in His countenance, as they behold His throne which is from everlasting to everlasting, and know that His kingdom is to have no end, they break forth in rapturous song, "Worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain, and hath redeemed us to God by His own most precious blood." Before I continue, I'll be sharing to you one of my worst experience when I was a child. When I was young, my father worked abroad. I cannot remember if I am 5 years old or around four to five back then. And actually, my father just worked 1 year abroad, but for me, those 1 year is I describe it as a 1 year of hell. Imagine, I was still young back then, and There was a time wherein my father got sick while he was in abroad. Actually, before he left in the Philippines, while he's still in the airport, what was in his mind is that what if he will not be able to go back to the Philippines again and he will not be able to see us. And while he was there, he got sick and wasn't able to send money for us. And that time, my mother doesn't have any work anymore. And what happened was, we do not have anything, any money to supply our daily needs. Actually, I really thank God that I still grew up as big as I am right now. Because during that time, life has been really unfair to us. You know the feelings we're in. We even experienced like there are four of us, my mother and my two other sisters. We have to eat. We are sharing our food in one plate. Try to survive for the next months to come. And there was a time wherein my mother is actually trying to find work. And I have to, actually when I was 5 years old, I already start going to school. But I have to stop to take care of my younger sister. And it's really hard for me because back then I was really very small and my sister, which is almost 1 year old back then, is big. I don't know where she is right now. Life has been really hard for us during that time. Cell phone is still not that famous. Actually, I don't know if there is one who is living in our barangay that have a cell phone. And the only way for us to communicate to our father is through, what do you call that? Through letters, which most of the time arrive after few weeks, month. And also, we also tried it before to record our voices in a cassette tape and send it abroad, and that is also what my father did. During that time, I've said that I am also thinking that what if I will not be able to see my father again? What if the only way for us to communicate is through that letters and through that cassette tapes? And one day, since communication back then is very hard, my father arrived without even informing us. We were just shocked when I was in the house of my uncle. I saw a beautiful car coming and suddenly my father came out. And I was really shocked because finally, what was in my mind during the time is that finally, our life will not be the same anymore because my father has arrived. You know, what God has prepared for us is more than that. And I hope that, and just like how the people who will be redeemed will be very happy because they will experience living with God. I hope that as we live in this earth, we will also have that same hope while waiting for God. It says our first theme will be the song of Moses, the servant of God. The second theme will be the song of the Lamb, the song of grace and redemption. This song will be louder, loftier, and in sublimer strains, echoing and re-echoing through the heavenly courts. Thus the song of God's providence is sung, connecting the varying dispensation for all is now seen without a veil between the legal, the prophetical, and the gospel. It says, those who conquer sing the song of Moses in the song of the Lamb, In it, they praised God for His justice and holiness. On that day, we will sing praises to God because finally, He redeemed us. And finally, we will never experience the sorrow of this earth. We will praise God for His greatness for us. And lastly, it says here, Jesus is soon coming, and our position should be that of waiting and watching for His appearing. We should not allow anything to come in between us and Jesus. We must learn here to sing the song of heaven, so that when our warfare is over, we can join in the song of the heavenly angels in the city of God. What is that song? It is praise and honor and glory unto Him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever. The very simple reminder for us is, we have seen what will be our life or what will be our experience in heaven. The kind of song that we will be singing, how we will have fellowship with one another, how we will worship God. The quotation is telling us that while we are here on earth, may we have that same song in our heart, so that when time will come, we will be part of those people who will also sing praises to God when we will be with Him in heaven. I hope and pray that as we stay on this earth, we will always put in our heart and mind what God had prepared for us and what kind of life will we have there. Because only through this that we can be able to live a life that will prepare us for the soon coming of Christ and for that promise of the blessed hope that God will be preparing for us. So as we end, may in our everyday life, we will live a life that focuses on how we have to prepare for the soon coming of Christ. May we put heaven in our heart and mind. May we practice singing the song of heaven. Because if until now, the song of our heart is still the song of earth, we will never experience or we will never be happy singing the song that will be sung in heaven. You know, if until now, worship is still not the best experience for us, we will never enjoy being in heaven because that will be the center of our activity there. It will be to worship our God. I hope and pray that these things will be part of our life, part of our daily living, so that as we wait for the soon coming of Christ, we will be prepared and we will be part of those people who will sing praises to God because finally, we have seen our Redeemer face to face. God bless us all.